So there you were. One day, you're looking for this piece of software that you really need. There's some good-looking search results. One of them is from GitHub. There's a download link. And you're back to square one because you have no idea what the f*** that is. If the file has a tar extension, or even tar followed by yet another extension, you're looking at a tarball. Welcome to Nick's Tricks. I am Nick, and this is Tarballs. These are tar. You get it. How's it going, guys? Welcome back to the channel. Today we're gonna shed some light into the fine art of archiving and compressing files. Let's get one thing straight. Archiving is not the same as compressing. The reason why this misconception even exists in the first place is that most mainstream archiving software conveniently provide compression as well. You can think of archiving as taking a bunch of files and simply just putting them together into one single file. Compression is then the process you apply to this archive in order to reduce its file size. In other words, if you archive 100 files of 1 megabyte each, you will get an archive whose size will be around 100 megabytes. In a typical Unix environment, you can already have multiple utilities play nice with one another via pipes and redirects, but tar here actually provides an option to specify which compression utility to use directly if you have it installed and if you want to add compression to your archives. The name tar is short for tape archive. The tapes in question refer to those magnetic storage drives that were all the rave back in the 50s. When they would fill up, they would get taken out and locked away into storage rooms, effectively archiving them. A time before hard drives and solid-state drives when a couple of mainframes would take up an entire room. The tar utility was released for Unix in 1979 as a way to write multiple files efficiently on tapes. Time passed, but despite the groundbreaking changes to the computer world since, tar has lost none of its power or value. To this day, it is primarily used as a solid and reliable tool for incremental backups and software distribution. And the archived files that you create with tar are called tarballs. To use the tar command, you'll have to know its syntax and options. They're each one letter in length, so it's really easy to remember. I like to go with the compression option first if I'm going to use any. Then the type of operation, extract or create. Then optionally V for verbose. Then F to specify the name of the archive. And then the path to whatever it is we're archiving. One thing about naming. While Linux does not rely on file extensions as heavily as some other operating systems, they are still important for determining file types and which applications can work with them. So it's always a good idea to communicate clearly the purpose of a file in as many ways as possible. If you're not familiar with all of these different compression utilities, don't worry about it for now. You can trust gzip to be really fast and efficient in any situation. Bzip is typically used for large text-based datasets, and it uses more resources to compress and decompress. And you can usually see XZ being used in ISO image files to achieve impressive compression ratios, but at an even higher resource cost. Let's jump into a terminal and try some examples. I'm using brace expansion here to create some more directories and files inside. Now I will create a simple tar archive, but it's going to sit outside of this directory since we don't want it included in the archive as it gets created. I'm going one level up to see the tarball and using the T option to list its contents and verify its integrity. I'm also opening Nautilus, the default file manager in GNOME, to see my archive and open it with the graphical archive manager. If you need to browse the contents of the archive inside a terminal, you can also use Vim and navigate through the archive structure. Let us now extract the archive and notice how it'll just dump all the contents in the current directory. It really made a mess here, so if this is not what you normally want, you can pass it an argument for the path. Let me clean up real quick and make another directory first. I'm extracting the archive again, but passing tar the argument capital C for change directory before any operations. And now you can find everything neatly in there, not bothering anyone. In a similar way, you can create compressed archives. Pass in the Z option first to specify the compression utility. This is for a gzip. And the extension will be tar.gz. Then we have j, lowercase j for bzip2, that's tar.bz. And capital J for xz, and that would be tar.xz. Behold the tarballs. The first one is the uncompressed tar archive, then our bzip2, gzip, and xz, and this information actually comes from the file headers. Time for a quick bonus tip. Sometimes archives can get pretty large, even with compression. So if the storage media has some type of size limitation, a common practice is to split the archive into sequential parts. So I'm going to show you how to do that really easily with the split command. I've created a 100 megabyte file with random data, and I'm going to archive it, even if the compression ratio is gonna suck, but we're going to split it into chunks of 40 megabytes. The first argument is B for block size, then the name of the file we're trying to split, and then the file name template for the parts. Keep in mind it's going to append something like AA, AB, AC, and so on to our template. And these are our chunks. Their sizes are rounded up, but they add up to 100 megabytes. To join them back, you can simply concatenate them back into a single file. You can see that there's no difference between our original tarball and the one that we just got from joining the chunks back together. I'm cleaning the current directory a bit by deleting every file that is not named file-something, and now I'm extracting our file here just for show. This concludes our video for this week. The inspiration behind it was actually the show Archive 81 on Netflix. I've seen it a while ago, but it's been on my mind the whole week for some reason, so I started watching it again. Anyway, I really hope this video helps you understand what tar is, what the difference between archiving and compression is, and that the next time you encounter a tarball, you will see it for what it is. My name is Nick, and I make these videos weekly. This is a new channel, which means it doesn't quite have its audience figured out just yet. If you enjoy this type of content, you can help greatly by hitting like, dropping a comment, or subscribing. Thank you so much for watching, have a great day, and I'll see you in the next one.